So we're going to talk about our kind of thinking that we've been doing in that particular working group.
So we're going to briefly introduce a little bit of what it entails to actually produce a guideline. Because I think it's not just about theory, it's also about practice. And we have to keep in mind that talking about causality, making guidelines, is also nowadays a practice. There's loads of people working, there's processes, there's institutions, there's money involved. This is a practice, this is a way of doing, way of living for some people. We're going to talk a bit about current challenges in guideline development, so what is actually happening in the guideline community to give some kind of a feel. We're going to discuss how we're going to go about it. Can I just have a quick feel of the room? Because I'm aware there are clinicians down the room. Are there guideline makers in the room? Yes. And systematic reviewers. Who is a systematic reviewer? Yeah? And patients? There are some patients in the room?
All of us.
From patient groups, representatives? Right, okay, let's go ahead and press on and see what's going on in the guideline community. So first, let's talk about guideline production.
So I think we've heard a lot about perhaps what clinical guidelines might be and what they're not, but this is a statement that we often use. It's a relatively recent one, but it does build on a lot of thinking. So the statements that include recommendations intended to optimise patient care, they're informed by a systematic review of evidence. I think that's a very important word. And we talk about how they evaluate the quality of the relevant scientific literature and an assessment of the likely benefits and harms. But we also talk here about selecting the best care based on his or her preferences. And that could be much wider, as we heard in the session before. So how do we think about clinical guidelines in that context? I mean, I think we are where we are with clinical guidelines, but there's a long history. Well, it says a short history there, but it's getting long by there. So we started out in the 70s and 80s with these very much consensus-based statements. They're often described as gobsat, good old boys sat around a table who probably knew what they wanted to say in the first place. They were just there to kind of ratify what should be done. We then were moved into the evidence-based movement in kind of the late 1980s, and then much more of a move to multidisciplinary-based guidelines. And certainly from the 1990s, that kind of role of guideline development moved out of the kind of professional colleges, the professional organisations, much more into these national institutions, as Sitz has just said. And I think that's a real challenge for us at the moment about how we develop our processes and methods with these big institutions. But, you know, we were talking earlier about using judgment in clinical practice. We need judgment in developing clinical guidelines as well. So now we're in the kind of 2000s and present day where we are thinking much more about the complexity of evidence-based medicine in that context of individualised practice. So how do we develop clinical guidelines? Well, we use the principles of evidence-based medicine. We increasingly adhere to international standards for methods and process, and very, you know, similar to that kind of reductionist approach. When these standards first came out, they were quite high level, they were principles, they were kind of guidance. Over the years, these are moving much more into kind of rules, checklists that we need to follow, certain practices that need to be followed, otherwise your guideline is not considered to be of high quality. The challenge for us is these are complex processes. The technical challenges are complex. Developing our evidence reviews are complex. But then we're doing this in a kind of very much a social context as well. So I think our guidelines, certainly from a NICE perspective, we try really hard to make those decisions, those assumptions, as open and transparent as possible. We perhaps don't do it as well as we could do, particularly those kind of underlying assumptions, but they're also open to influence. NICE, again, publishes much of its guidance out there for consultation, and those comments will make changes. So we identify and refine what's to be covered. That's a really important stage. What's going to be covered in that guideline? Who are the people that we're talking about? Who's going to benefit from these practice guidelines? We then look at getting the evidence to answer those key clinical questions, and we tend to do this in, again, a very structured and focused way, not least to make it doable. You know, we have resource constraints, but also to make sure that those are the right questions being asked. Very technical process. But then we take that evidence to our guideline committees, who will look at that evidence, deliberate, make judgments, make assumptions, try and understand how that applies in this particular context. And then we translate that evidence into recommendations, which is very much a social process. It's based on the theory of small group work and how people can come to a consensus within that committee.
So the work involves a lot of processes, and actually they go through this in a quite flexible kind of way. There's a scoping procedure, there's a review protocol that needs to be made, there's data research, there's analysis, there's the grading that has to be happening. Everybody knows what grading is, so you have to look at the evidence and see whether or not it's appropriate for this research question. There's evidence statements to be made, there's evidence and recommendations to be made, you have to write that down. There's getting the wording right, there's a whole process of stakeholder feedback, there's a publication, and all kind of pathways you have to consider. And then there's a kind of meta coordination going on in the same place to see if do we need to improve processes, is there anything else we need to change at the same time. So in itself, there's an overview of the whole NICE process. There's a whole diagram on it. You can see all this kind of this happening. Obviously, here it looks very nicely and boxed, and it's in one process. Obviously, all those things happen at the same time. You can imagine that happening. Just to give you a brief idea, what this is only a snippet of one of our clinical meetings. But just to give you an idea of what's actually happening in a group panel meeting. It was a very short day of an update, and you see that there's this kind of, you see panel members coming into the room, and then there's introductions, apologies, who is there, who's not there. There's a list of public attendees, so a nice, the public can actually can see the whole process going on. So you see on the right-hand side, there's open to the public, and there's parts that are actually closed to the public. So the public will be sitting there, has to be addressed, has to say, well, now you can stay in the room, now you have to get out of the room. There has to be the objectives of the day, this will be the minutes of last meeting. There will be declarations of interest, and that's a very important part. So every meeting, again, there's like, is there anything new happening that could actually be of interest, and that could actually be causing a conflict of interest in this guideline, maybe. There will be, for example, this was like a feedback meeting of the stakeholder comments. We'll introduce that into the final recommendation where we'll shape that. It can take anything from like 10 minutes up to 2 hours to get to the final recommendation. Then there will be some kind of wordings from the implementation and communications lead, like this word does work, but this doesn't work, or we should not be saying that, but the comma here is not really right, or this actually doesn't fit with the other recommendation. There's a whole process going on there. And then we also, there's the NICE pathway, so you have like your paper version, but that also has to be introduced into a computer version, which actually causes all kinds of new problems and conflicts, and you can't, I'll spare the details on that, but you can understand that's very intricate to work on that. And then, well, this time we had lunch, but it usually takes a whole day, this goes over a few months to get this whole work done. Right, let's get to the next bit. So you have a bit of an idea of what's going on in guideline production, and that is actually a thing that we're doing, it's a practice. And if you think about changing the world, well, you have to change this kind of practice and policies too. So let's think about the challenges in development, because there's many issues. And actually, guideline developers are aware of those kind of things. They may not actually show them in practice, but they are aware on a meta level that things are need to be changing. So first of all, there's a problem with the different kinds of knowledge, there's purpose of guideline making, the different kinds of reasoning, integrating problems, and different kinds of validations. So let's go through them.
So when we talk about different types of knowledge, we know that guidelines already use knowledge from a wide range of sources. So that's happening already. As I said, we know this. This is what we do. We do tend to use lots of randomised controlled trials. You know, if we're thinking about what works, that tends to be the go-to source of evidence. But when we think about using that evidence, we use lots of other types of knowledge. Whether it's as explicit as it could be, I think, is a big question. But we do use the views and experience of people using services or people delivering them. That's either through our stakeholder consultation, through the testimony of people on those committees or our expert witnesses, or through research, you know, where we look for qualitative evidence on people's views and experiences. We might want to know how an intervention works, so really kind of getting into the mechanics of it. What's the logic? You know, what's the theory behind these interventions? We might want to think about the cause of disease. how's this come about? And increasingly thinking about context of care. So for example, NICE a few years ago did not think about the resource implications of its recommendations. We considered cost effectiveness, that was a big, you know, pillar of our decision making, but we are increasingly now thinking about resource implications. So, you know, the context of care forms part of that. You don't get that information from randomised controlled trials. And increasingly, as guidelines are being used for different purposes, so we had the definition of clinical guidelines earlier, but we now do guidelines on public health, we do guidelines on social care, and they all have different aims, we might want to use different types of evidence. So recently we published the traffic-related air pollution. A lot of that evidence base was based on mathematical models of how putting trees in a street may or may not have an effect on the air quality in that location. And a really important point here, we also use that expert knowledge of the guideline committee, of which there are always patient or service user members on there. I always think if we didn't value that expert knowledge, actually we wouldn't bother with the committees. They're an expensive part of the process, but that's such a key part of developing good guidelines. So we, you know, I adhere to this principle, evidence-based medicine does mean integrating clinical expertise, patient values and the best available evidence. I think the challenge is we don't know how to do that well. That's why we as a group are trying to think about how we might do that. And in fact, guidelines based on an overall narrow definition of evidence may limit their use. Again, we heard a really good example before. But, you know, we are, you know, there's a real risk of being particularly reductionist in this, really focusing on very, perhaps the more easily answerable questions, which may not be those real issues to the patients or the practitioners. So when we think about why we need different knowledge, one of our group members, Fergus Macbeth, was our clinical director for a number of years, and this is his kind of schema. But he talks about how we kind of start out with evidence, so that's our technical reports, our technical processes. We then apply scientific values to that, so whether the methods are good, are they answering that question in a scientifically robust way. We then apply those social values, you know, that discussion about the committee, what do we value? We've had a really good example recently where we were developed a recommendation with a very limited evidence base, but it was a principle of care that we wanted to reflect the values of our community. And then we develop a recommendation. So why do we need these different types of knowledge in this process? Well, we might have uncertainty. We may have good data, but it leaves us with uncertainty. And that may be something we should be better at living with. It could be imperfect, so it's not quite what we wanted. As I said, we're increasingly talking about things like context and the professional and cultural norms that come into these kind of decisions. One of the biggest things for us as guideline developers over the last few years is how we think about the professional, financial and academic interests. How do we build that? Everyone comes with some kind of interest or bias. How do we account for that in our guideline development processes and make that as explicit as possible?
So another interesting question is actually what are the verbs of guideline making? And if you ask it in a group of guideline makers, this is actually a very hard question. So what do we actually do with this guideline? What are our intentions with that? And actually there are many, many reasons we find out to work with those. But maybe the most important one, and skip that to the next one, is actually in one way or the other, we want actually to support the clinical decision. That's actually the ultimate goal for a lot of guideline makers. But actually, we don't know actually how we're doing that. And then if you ask them, so how is actually a clinical decision being made? Then actually, as clinical, as guideline makers, we're not completely aware actually what is involved in that whole process. And obviously, from a more philosophical point of view, you could say, well, actually, we're trying to infer, you're trying to make some kind of decision with the patient there, and have some kind of deliberation of what's going to happen next, so what's the future? We're still, you know, maybe that all kind of, we're visionaries still saying, well, this might happen, so now we're going to do this. So if you think about if the clinical decision-making that kind of way, so actually how do we infer? How do we make this decision? How do guidelines actually help you to make that kind of inferences? And evidence-based medicine may have been focusing on just one way of doing that. It's just actually a way of saying, well, we had 10 or 1,000 patients like you, and they did this. But maybe we should maybe broaden up our ideas, and I think there's many people in the room will have a good idea on that, and we'll explain that to us in the next few days. So this obviously are a couple of things that we came up with our limited notions in the guideline group, but we are aware that we have to broaden up that kind of idea that if you want to be supported by guideline makers, you have to actually maybe broaden out that kind of frequencies to reasoning and bring in other kinds of reasoning that might be helpful to help that decision making. So there's many ways of doing that, and I think this is just a question of time-wise. I'll just maybe just skip this one. There's a lot of questions of how to do this, but guidelines, I'm actually not completely aware how we can actually help guideline makers doing this kind of process. And the next question is, like, we are aware that there's different kind of knowledge about, but we don't know about actually how the integration goes. So that's actually what Trisha was referring to, seconds. A paradigm saying, well, there has to be like evidence and clinical decision making, sorry, clinical experience and clinical expertise and patient values, and it has to be integrated. But actually, we don't know how that integration actually works, how that goes about. So one of the ideas obviously is about mindlines, this idea by Gabby and LeMay, that actually the decision making is not a kind of an explicit process, but it's mostly based on, well, your personal experience as a doctor, as a patient, you bring that into the room, you had, well, there's some input, obviously, somewhere, of course, you read something, or you heard something from a colleague, but actually your decision making is more kind of a fluid kind of way, and they describe that kind of knowledge, that kind of that almost untouchable knowledge as mindset, is actually where you base your decision on. Well, it would be very interesting to think about, like, so how do knowledges actually weigh, and how do you integrate them, how do you judge them, how do you evaluate them, how do you deliberate? Those kind of things, we're just scratching the surface, I think, about that, what's actually happening in the room. I think we can just distill a black box, as you say. So the third part is actually about, so what is now happening in the guideline community? I think we have to get away from the idea that the guideline community is so evidence-based medicine, and we just have to fight that. There's actually a lot of things happening in the guideline community. And I think that they're struggling with these challenges, and they're trying to resolve them in one way or the other. If we go to the next slide. I think that's, yeah, too. It's like there's maybe two ways way what you see happening. I think there's a part of the guideline community is saying, well, let's apply evidence-based medicine more strictly. So actually, really get really strict procedures in this. To resolve this problem, get more evidence-based medicine. We're still doing it wrong. It has to be stricter and harder and more precise and more pure. There's a quest to find all the data, all trials. See, and I don't oppose that we should not find all data. I think we should have a lot of data, but we might not be resolving the challenges we're actually having. There's a real focus on conflicts of interest. There are lists about like what should be a conflict of interest or not. A conflict of interest, and that's very interesting. So there's conflict of interest because that you see in a frequentist way of reasoning, you want to have no conflicts of interest, which you see is impossible, but we don't know how to deal with that. So there's a tendency to make lists and to be very strenuous about, okay, we know who is who and what they're doing, what their interests are, what they bring to us, what kind of bias actually they bring into the room. Structured work environments, you may know, for example, the Magic app, where they actually also categorize now patient values, so you have evidence and patient values all in the list. So patients in your case would mostly value this and this and this. These kind of things are happening. There's data mining techniques. There's evidence to recommendation frameworks, a whole list that you could consider when you're making evidence and getting to a recommendation. So I think that's a part of getting it really strictly out. You want to get more evidence to resolve this kind of. On the other hand, I think there's an acknowledgement that there are all kinds of causality. So within Cochrane, within GIN, within I think many guideline communities, there's kind of this kind of thing happening. We have people from Brave here later on. There is an acknowledgement like, okay, maybe we should go into the philosophy and think about, well, what Brian has said in ontology, what are our assumptions before we make actually guidelines. So there's an acknowledgement that there are different kind of knowledges that we have to include. There is the idea about facilitating sharing experiences and to identify questions for methodological development. So there are things moving about, but it goes slowly, and I think there's two ways to go about it.